divine inspiration, divine interference, or divine good luck. Something happened in the city of brotherly love in the spring of 74 that hasn't happened in so long, it was beyond belief. Philadelphia, the city of losers, finally had themselves a winner. The ever-loving Philadelphia Flyers. Not only a winner, but the first expansion team in the history of the National Hockey League to ever capture the coveted Stanley Cup. It all came true on a pleasant Sunday afternoon in late May. Outside the spectrum, crocuses crocused, roses budded, and the birds and bees, well, they did whatever birds and bees do on a 78-degree afternoon in spring. Inside, 17,007 screaming zealots realized a fall-winter-spring dream that few thought possible. While Bobby and Bernie carried Stanley's mug aloft in a traffic jam of humanity, they dreamt the impossible dream. They not only dreamt it, they witnessed it. It's a dream not ever to be forgotten.
Now it comes to center. Azora's out there with 15 seconds. Puck goes to Barber down into the Boston zone. 13 seconds left in the game. 10 seconds. Orr shoots it down the ice. Girard makes the save. Ladies and gentlemen, the Flyers are going to win the Stanley Cup! The Flyers win the Stanley Cup! The Flyers win the Stanley Cup! The Flyers have won the Stanley Cup!
For the first time ever, a post-1967 team have become the champions on a great effort by an entire club. Bernie Perrott is being literally mobbed. Bobby Clark was thrown to his back by his teammates. The Flyers and the Bruins go through the traditional handshaking ceremony. It's almost unbelievable to even realize at this particular point, as Clark and Orr embrace, Perrott and Orr, of course, former teammates, Perrott coming from the Boston organization. But it's almost impossible to believe. But there it is. The Flyers own the Stanley Cup for 1974. They are the best in the National Hockey League. And now, down on the ice, Tony Perrott wins the Conn Smythe trophy as the most valuable player in the Stanley Cup Series. A most deserved trophy. The gleaming Stanley Cup, carried by NHL President Clarence Campbell as he tries to make his way to the ice and to the microphone. Clarence Campbell still pinned in, but you can pick up the silver gleam of the cup that is emblematic of hockey supremacy in the National Hockey League. Bernie Perrott and Bobby Clark raise the Stanley Cup to their respective shoulders in tandem, try to move around the ice. If the fans would only get off the ice and let them skate around in the traditional skate, all you can see is the cup amidst a sea of people. Clark and Perrott, as the Flyers now truly are number one in professional hockey.
The mystical, magical road to the Stanley Cup is one that could never be found in a Rand McNally atlas. It's a combination of good luck, hard work, and divine intervention. Hidden in the fog-filled past are such master coups as the acquisition of Bobby Clark, Rick McLeish, Ross Lonsbury, Dave Schultz, Bill Barber, Bill Flett, Andre DuPont, and a host of other talented, gutsy, team-oriented players. Joe Watson sums it up best.
And I don't think we had the most talented team in hockey, but like I say, you know, it all comes from the heart, and that's what the guys seem to do, you know.
But one road sign along the highway to success reads perfectly clear. It says, Bernie Perrott, goaltender par excellence. The Flyers made a bold move, to some a discomforting move, when they traded away tried and true goalie Doug Favell to Toronto for Bernie Perrott. Doug had served the Flyers well since the early days, but somehow someone told somebody that Bernie Perrott wanted to win the Stanley Cup as much as the Flyers did. So Philly did the natural thing. They traded for Bernie Perrott. And from game one of the 73-74 season, Bernie did not disappoint, and Terry Crisp's goal got them off and running.
Pavel with a stick knocks it behind the net again. There's Kelly looking to center. Zaleski knocked down in there by Sittler. Right in front to Chris. A shot score! Who has really improved in that department this year, really worked overtime at digging that puck loose, finally got it out to Derek Crisp, who rifled one right around the ice, and the Flyers take a 1-0 lead late in the first period of play. Barber along the near side. Shot! Score!
In Game 2, Perrant did it again as the Flyers shut out the Islanders 6-0. And Bob Taylor led the cheers from the bench once more.
He was such an amazing person and goaltender that I learned a lot. And I also had the feeling, and most of us did throughout the year, that we could have a shot at winning it all. And you could give up a lot of games just to have your name inscribed on that Stanley Cup.
Against the Red Wings the next night, the Flyers were finally scored upon. Two quick goals by Detroit made it 2-0 before the Flyers battled back.
In by Berenson. Now it's Zaleski. The center ice for Chris. He's broken up by Berenson. Berenson has it at his own line. Circles inside the Detroit line. Passes behind Del Vecchio. Zaleski across the line. Chris is open. Zaleski shot. Back end. Center ice. Flips one to the near Detroit corner. Rebound. Zaleski hits the side of the net. Kinderchuk for the rebound. Zaleski checked off the puck. Kinderchuk's got it. Circling. Looking. Holding. Shot. Into a screen. Knocked down. Another shot. And it's not scored! Game two! The go-ahead goal by James Stoops. And it's 3-2 the Flyers. Coming to center ice. Pass crisp. He's got his man Libet on the far wing. Gets over that line. Into that far side. Tries to hit his man. And it's got crisp. And he's going to play forward to McLean. He's all the way in. He shoots. He scores! A short-handed goal. And it's 4-2 Philadelphia. And the suction explodes as Rick McLean scores for a case of face to case.
The Flyers raised their record to 4-0 on the first game of their West Coast trip by blasting California 5-1. But continuing their West Coast swing, the Flyers first tasted defeat at Vancouver and then Los Angeles. And then returning home to Philadelphia, the Flyers were leveled 4-0 by Montreal. That flattened their record to an unimpressive 4-3 until the Flyers started flying again against the flightless Penguins. The next night, California succumbed to the Flyers 2-1. Then in the first meeting between the two best in the West, Bernie Perrant posted his fourth shutout of the season as he turned back 27 out of 27 Blackhawks shots, while Tony Esposito turned back 27 out of 28 Flyers shots. Bill Barber got the winner late in the first period.
Clark with a rebound out in front of Fleck. That shoves it to McLeish along the near circle. They're controlling the puck well now. Back to Barber. He'll get a shot. Let's it go. Score!
The win over Chicago made it 3 in a row for the high-flying Flyers. They went on to douse Atlanta's Flames 2-1 in the next game, and then routed Pittsburgh 7-0 in the next one. While Ross Lounsbury and Bobby Clark had two goals apiece, Bernie Perrant posted his fifth shutout.
Barber, Ashby, and DuPont, far left circle. McMenamin, Polis, and Fonovo for Pittsburgh with Watson and Dave Rose. McMenamin, fresh out of college, takes the draw against Clark. Gauthier wants to see just right before he drops the puck. Now he does. Barber shifts it back to Ashby. Shot wide of the short side. Cams to the near board. Watson battling DuPont for it. DuPont rolls it into Barber. Cleared out by McMenamin. In there is Ashby to poke it free. But finally, the Pens do get it to center ice. Polis there. Flyers jam it right back into Heron behind his net. Sets it up for Ashby. Watson right in front. It's touched off. Rebound.
Five shutouts in your first 12 games. This had to tell you something not only about your own improvement as an NHL goaltender, but also about the overall defensive capabilities of the Flyers as a team. What are your comments about that?
Well, I think, you know, what proves one thing is You know, five shutouts. What happened is I think it's the great system we played, you know, like we had from Fred Shaw and Mike Nicolak, you know, is let's face it, Don, you don't make any mistakes in your own end. They don't score any goals.
The next game, the Flyers made it 6 in a row with a 4-1 victory over Detroit. The Flyers scored 4 times in the third period to win this one. On November 24th against the St. Louis Blues, Bernie Parent came up with his 6th shutout of the season. Ross Lonsbury netted the game winner at 19:42 in the second period.
Thank you, Lonsbury, to Dornhoff, right on your front.
At Thanksgiving, the Flyers continued to lead in the West with a record of 13-6-1 for 27 points. Atlanta and Chicago were tied for second with 24 points apiece. On December 2nd, it was a wild game against California. The Flyers won it 5-1 at the final buzzer, but before that, a wild scene took place when Bobby Clark was jumped by Barry Cummins of the Seals. Clark needed 20 stitches to close a head wound, but the Flyers retaliated en masse. Boston came from behind to tie the Flyers. Then the Flyers returned the compliment in Chicago with Gary Dornhofer's first goal of the season.
As he feeds Dornhofer on the right wing. Dorney back to McLeish. Drop pass. Dornhofer. The drive. He scores! Dornhofer scores for Case the Tasty Cakes. All tied up 2-2.
Dorney, if there were any skeptical Flyer fans, they had to become believers after you scored the game tire in Chicago, after the club was down 2-0, especially on Chicago Stadium ice. Do you remember that goal?
Very well, Don. You know, that's probably one of the hardest places to play in the National Hockey League. And I remember I was standing to the left of Tony Esposito, you know, cruising towards the goal, and Ricky was in the right corner, and he saw me moving in, and he passed the puck across to me, and, you know, it just hit my stick, and I shot right in the net, and that tied the game, and that's the way it ended up that night.
The Flyers dropped a tight one to Atlanta in mid-December at the Spectrum. That left them in front of Chicago by only 1 point. And then the next night, the Flyers shut out the Islanders 4-0 as Rick McLeish and Bill Barber scored key first-period goals.
On the backhand, rolls to the near side. Blayton will dig it out. Shoves it back to Barber at the point. Barton back to Blayton along the near side. Gagnon putting pressure on. Blayton back to the point again. Barber retreats. Back to Blayton. He's in the near corner. Has trouble with it. Poked away by Potvin. Back to Barber. His shot stopped in front. Back with a backhander. Another shot blocked. The rebound score by Rick McLeish for a case of safety kick. Nowhere to go. Back to Barber. Shot score! Barber through a screen. Fires right through Jerry Hart. Who's not Potvin and Desjardins for a case of safety kick. And it's kept in by Blayton. To Chris. Chris can't get a shot away. Shovels it across for Schultz, but it's cleared to the far boards by Marshall. Ashby keeps it in the zone. Feeds to Schultz on the far right. Schultz controlling. Centering pass. Zaleski. A drive from point blank range.
Score! Zaleski scores for a case of basic taking.
Clement across the New York line. Dornhofer's open. Got the puck. Back to Clement. Score! Bill Clement from Dornhofer for a case of basic taking.
2 games later, the Blackhawks invaded Philly. Showing the poise, determination, and sheer guts they were made of, the Flyers rallied from a 2-1 deficit in the third period to beat the Blackhawks 4-2.
Barber against Paul. Now Pappin has run out. That's going in. Great shot. Right there. Barber right there. Scores! Bobby Clark. And the Flyers lead it 3-2.
Dave Schultz celebrated 1974 with a hat trick against the New York Rangers.
McDuffie clears it off the boards. Onto the stick of Zaleski. Right out in front. The crazy shot. Hey, rebound shot. Score! Hey, Schultz. And it's 1-0.
Schultz across the New York line. Still going. Pulls the puck in. Bouncing puck in the slot. Loose in front. McDuffie back.
They call you the hammer, yet you come up with a hat trick against the Rangers. Is confidence the big difference in your play this year over last year?
I think not only confidence, but just the experience of being in the National Hockey League and watching some of these guys with so much talent. You know, you just pick up so much just sitting and watching, and experience and confidence both.
Dave, what is your philosophy on fighting in hockey? There are those that say you go looking for trouble. Others, a bit more sophisticated to the ways of pro hockey, say that your fighting ability is a psychological weapon. What are your comments?
Well, it is a psychological weapon. It's, you know, the thing of intimidation, and you know, it's not something that I use to hurt anyone physically, but sometimes you can slow another team up, even especially another player, and when you're doing this, you know, it's going to give you the edge, and you know, I want to win the hockey game. That's all I care about, and if fighting helps, then that's what I'm going to do.
The Flyers clung to a tenuous lead in the Western Division through the early part of January. On January 13th, against the Atlanta Flames, Bernie Parent's eighth shutout of the year, coupled with Don Selesky's third-period goal, gave Philly a big one.
With Jimmy Watson racing for it, trailed by Lysiak, gets it just near the goal line, retreats behind the net, reverses away from Lysiak, comes to the near side, off the boards looking for Schultz. Schultz has it up to Kindlechuk, too far. Arnie Brown playing it now at center ice, loses it to Zaleski, comes to the near board, over center, fires it down alongside Mirror, steers it away from Schultz, but Zaleski's in there, tries to knock it behind the net, Schultz behind, trying to come out in front, Zaleski scores!
The Flyers' 7-2 rout of Buffalo made it two wins in a row at the Spectrum. And then Bernie Parent shut out the Kings 2-0 in the next game to make it 3 in a row. The amazing Mr. Parent turned his 10th shutout of the season against the California Seals on January 25th. Despite two nights later, at the All-Star break, the Flyers held an 8-point lead over second-place Chicago. On Groundhog Day, the Flyers made the Red Wings dig for cover. 5 Philadelphia goals in the first period set the tone of that game. After losing the night before in Boston 5-3, the Flyers returned to the Spectrum on February 10th to defeat the Montreal Canadiens 3-1. Bobby Clark scored his 24th and 25th goals of the year.
Both number 16s. Loose puck. Clement taps it back to Jimmy Watson. Drives it deep in the right wing corner. Clark checks out the puck. In front, Bill Clement. Big save, Clement. He drew one of that far corner, and Clement just gets the pad out in time. Benefits center ice on the right wing to Clement. Across the line. Gets by Wilson. Spun away by Richard. Clark back to Vanner. Through a screen. Not wide. Powder. Got it back. A shot by Clement is wide.
I think you get satisfaction out of every goal, but I think when you score a big goal for your club, it gives you a lot greater satisfaction.
Rick McLeish tallied his 25th and 26th of the year to guide the Flyers. Then in the next two games, the Flyers rallied in the third period to tie the powerful Rangers and Canadiens. The amazing Bernie Parent came up with his 12th shutout of the season against the powerful Montreal Canadiens. Two Bill Flett goals paced the attack and kept Philadelphia 3 points ahead of the hard-charging Blackhawks. The Flyers were roaring now. All systems were go. On March 16th against Minnesota, the high-flying Flyers notched their 8th straight victory by a score of 4-2. A 2-2 tie against the Maple Leafs the next night left the Flyers 9 points ahead of the Blackhawks and well ahead of the rest of the division in the Western race. The Flyers continued to pour it on through the end of March, and on March 30th, the writing was on the wall. At the Spectrum, the Flyers finally beat the Boston Bruins. The win clinched the Western Division Clarence Campbell Bowl for the Flyers, but more than that, it was a moral victory that would reap dividends in the Stanley Cup Finals. With the score tied 2-2 in the second period, Bill Flett and Bobby Clark sent Philadelphia away.
Taken away by Perani, picked up to Lansley, breaks the center, with McLeish on his left, over the line to Rick. Rick in a shot, great play, rebound by McLeish, score! Selesky at the blue line, up the middle to McLeish. McLeish gives to Lansbury in the near corner, he's knocked down. Lansbury is knocked hard by O'Reilly. McLeish gets the pass back to Jimmy Watson, shot right on, rebound, score! Flett up to center right. Still going, fires from the red line. Off of Sims, Flett gets it back again. Flett behind the Boston net. Centering pass.
Score! Bobby
Clark! Rolls it down behind the Boston net. Cashman in there with McLeish, who digs it out. Looking for a man. He has Dornhopper in front. Club shot. Just wide. Lansbury digs out the rebound. Tries to come out in front. It's loose. They poke at it. Back to Astley. A drive. Score! Clark screens off after on the fire. Flips it into the neutral zone. Back at his own line. 17 seconds, 15 seconds, trying to fire it into the Flyers' zone. Jimmy Watson fires it out off. God, man, that's going to do it. The Flyers are going to win the championship. Let's just let him count down. There it is. The Flyers are national champions. West of the
By virtue of their solid first-place finish in the Western Division, the Flyers had announced to the hockey world that they were a team to be reckoned with. After all, no team from the Western Division, much less an expansion team, had ever won the Stanley Cup. Who were these Flyers anyway? And what were they trying to prove? Philadelphia answered that in the quarterfinal series against Atlanta. After a 4-1 victory in the first game, the Flyers went one better in the second. After a Terry Crisp goal in the first period, Rick McLeish scored three in the second as Philadelphia rolled to a 5-1 second game victory.
Up the roll, McLeish is all by himself, set, score! McLeish shoots, score!
Copper chasing it behind the net to Mir. There's Murray, skated off, Lansbury takes it, he's got McLeish in front!
Oh!
Rick, they say one secret to a winning team is the closeness and harmony of the players themselves. Just how close are the Flyers as a team individually?
We seem to be a well-knit team, and this is mainly one of the successes. It's been like this all year, and the guys get along well together and play good together, and this has helped us a lot.
With the scene shifting to Atlanta, the Flyers control Game 3 from the opening faceoff, scoring two in the opening period, winning 4-1. The Fighting Flyers had Atlanta on the ropes. In Game 4, home ice advantage meant nothing. The Flyers smelled blood, and maybe the Stanley Cup. Their march through Georgia in the final game would have left General Sherman green with envy.
Farmer closing, straight for the goal now. Blayton in the right wing corner. Puts it to McLeish, deep in the corner, back to Bladen. Fires, in a very heavy score! Don Happer for a case of Stacy Cake, a power play goal, and the Flyers have closed the lead to within one.
Now Barber moves it up to Dornhofer on the right wing. Back to Barber in the give and go, across the Atlanta line. Started to take the shot, was poked off his stick by Price. Clark keeps it in at the point. He's at the left point, out of the right point to Bladen. The drive, scores! The game is all tied up!
In overtime, Dave Schultz extinguished the Atlanta Flame, but good.
It's Clark. He's got Schultz going in. Schultz goes!
Dave Schultz wins the game for a case of Pasty Cake at 4-30, and the Flyers sweep the series.
Dave, skeptics say that you're not a scorer, yet you come up with a goal in sudden death overtime to give the Flyers a win in the quarterfinals.
I was kind of playing very offensive in the game, and I kept going for the net. And it was a play that happened a few other times. I kind of carried the puck over center ice, and just as I got to the blue line, I give it over to Bill Flett on right wing. And a couple of times we tried to get it back just as we broke towards the net, but finally it worked. I give it to him, he give it over to Bobby Clark, and I just broke for the net, and the defensive went for Bobby Clark. Clark, you just give it to me, and I went in all alone.
One final comment, Dave. The Stanley Cup, when you really get down to it, isn't this really the name of the game in the NHL?
Well, I mean, it's certainly just the greatest thing to win the Stanley Cup. But I think that, there's so many guys who play many, many years in the National Hockey League and never get a chance. And it's really a shame that so many guys have played so long and never won it. And here I am, my second year. And when you get in the Stanley Cup playoffs, there's just nothing like it. And I'm just so glad I was a part of it.
In the semifinals, the series shifted. It was no longer West against West. From here on, East met West. The Rangers were next on the Flyers' disassembly line. Now things got tough. The upstart Flyers were in against the rugged old guard of the pre-expansion National Hockey League. It was bound to be a tough series. The Rangers had talent, guts, and tradition on their side. The Flyers had talent, guts, and Kate Smith on their side. Not to mention Bernie Parent. In Game 1 at the Spectrum, Bernie worked his mischievous madness against the Rangers, and the New Yorkers fell 4-0.
As Giacomo tries to tie it up, Lansbury battles for it. It's behind the New York net. It's loose. McLeish stops it. Loose for Lansbury trying to turn the corner. Scores! Ross Lansbury beats Ed Giacomo to the short side. Chuck to Barber on the left wing. Gets behind Steele. Scores!
The Flyers just couldn't be beat in Philadelphia. In Game 2, Bobby Clark started it off in the first period.
He scores! For a case of Pasty Cake, and the Flyers have taken a first period 1-0 lead. Picked up by Flett. Flett back to Braden, gets the drive away. Kick save, deep rebound out to the left point.
Barber gets the draw. He scores! I think it might have been Barber all the way. As the screen was set up in front by Clark, and it's 2-0 Flyers. Barber for a case of Tasty Cake.
1,000 dreams have been shattered on the streets of Broadway. Semi-stars and pseudo-stars have gone home beggars and thieves when confronted by the bright lights of the Big Apple. The rough-and-tumble, devil-may-care Flyers came into New York City with their heads held high and were chased out with their tails between their legs. Game 3, Rangers 5, Flyers 3. Game 4, Rangers 2, Flyers 1. It took an overtime goal by Rod Gilbert to sink the Flyers in Game 4, but all the same, the fearless Flyers knew they were in the hassle of their lives with the big-time Rangers. In Game 5 at the Spectrum, New York continued their domination in the first period. Then in the second period, the Flyers refused to be intimidated.
Can't center, tied up by Nielsen, tries to poke it back. Again tied up, puck rolls free along the near side. Sunkowski up to McGregor, slap that. Barber tries to keep it in, does into the corner. Ceiling over skate, so does Dornhofer. Wound around to the far side. Slap behind the net by Bladen. McLeish is dumped by Nielsen, dug out in the near corner by Barber. Barber looking back to the point, now holds. Dumps it on the side of the net, shot, score! Rick McLeish!
Almost broken up from behind by Ted Irvin, so that's the end of the quarter. Settling pass, shot, oh, that's cleared out of the way by Park. Lansbury takes down one man, Rob. Now it's McLeish closing.
Looks for Bladen. He'll get the forehand drive. Let's it go, and it was wide, and he had the corner. Back to Clark at the near point. He closes in, closes in. Goes to Bladen again. He's got a point-blank shot.
Leading the series 3-2, the Flyers return to New York. A victory here would put them in the Stanley Cup Finals. Once again, the Rangers worked their voodoo Wall Street magic on the youngsters from Broad Street. When it was over, New York had tied the series at 3-3. But the final showdown was in Philly. In the first period, the Rangers broke on top with a Bill Fairbairn goal. The Flyers came back with Rick McLeish's 11th goal of the playoffs. In the second period, Philly scored twice. Steve Vickers made it close for the Rangers with a goal at 8:49. But Gary Dornhofer put it out of reach with this crushing tally.
Lansbury takes it away, though, into the corner, centering, and rolls to McLeish, far circle, looking for help. Right in front, Dornhofer scores!
Gary, you and Ed Jackman became very good friends during the just-completed Rangers series. Do you plan any sort of similar housewarming for Gilles Gilbert in Boston?
Well, I think you have to do it. You know, I won't be the only guy getting in front of Gilbert, but I think that you have to get in front of him, you have to bother him. And when he can't see the puck, you know, then he's going to be in trouble. You know, when you watch Boston play, guys like Hodge and Cashman, they get in front. And that's where Esposito scores a lot of his goals. So I think it's very important that somebody is stationed in front of Gilbert to give him a little bit of trouble.
The tough, talented Flyers had earned their way into the Stanley Cup Finals. Now their task was clearly marked. This time, for the first time in the playoffs, the Flyers didn't have home ice advantage. And just look back at the Rangers series and see how important home ice was. In the finals, the powerhouse Boston Bruins, who swept through the regular season with the best overall record, had the advantage. The Flyers entered the pit without the valuable services of All-Star defenseman Barry Ashby and Bob Hound Kelly, Rangers series.
Barry, every player in sports fears an eye injury, perhaps more than any other type. Let's go back to that game, and if you could, give us the recollections of the play that led up to your injury.
We were in overtime, and we had a faceoff at our end. In fact, we just made a player change when I came on the ice, and Clark, he said that, I remember I was waiting for him to draw the puck back. He said Demkowski pulled it back to Rolf, and my man then was to get Demkowski from in front of the net, or play Rolf if he came in. And all I remember was I played Stemkowski and come around and see where the puck was, and the next thing I knew, the puck just hit me in the face. I seen it about 2 feet away from me, so I can remember.
Game one took place at the Boston Garden. The Bruins blew to a first period 2-0 lead on goals by Cashman and Shepard. In the second period, Bernie Parent turned back 12 Bruin blasts as Orest Kindrichuk brought the Flyers back within one goal. In the third period, the strong-legged Flyers dominated play. Bobby Clark tied it up at 5:32. But in the final seconds, the amazing Bobby Orr ruined the Flyers' gutsy comeback. Game two at the Boston Garden started on the same sad note. Despite the inspired play of the Flyers, the battling Bruins led 2-0 after the first period. Early in the second period, Bobby Clark put the Flyers on the scoreboard. The Bruins held on to the slim 2-1 lead as the clock ticked away. And then coach Fred Shiro pulled his goaltender for an extra attack man, and the Flyers came out hunting for bear.
Girard coming for the bench. Flyers will go with six skaters. It's Dornhofer who's come on. Orr around to Hodge. He's tied up by Clark. Centering pass. Jeffery, he scores! Duplass scores! It's all tied up! And Moose gives the shuffle as he drill one through a screen, and we're all tied up. And that's a big goal for the Moose. Going into tonight's game, in 11 games played, to pick up two goals and two assists, and that has to be the biggest one yet.
In overtime, both teams had great chances to win it, but both goalies were superb. And then at the 12-minute mark, Bobby Clark worked his magic.
Forecheck by Clark. So Schultz breaks it up. Schultz behind the net, centers, flat, tries to Clark, shot, oh, rebound, goal!
Scores the game winner at 12 minutes and 1 second of sudden death overtime. He was blocked on the first shot. He made the second one, and the Flyers have picked up their win in Boston. The first win on this ice since November 12, 1967. And the Flyers come back home to the Spectrum all even in games in the Stanley Cup Finals 1-1.
We have a little more experience this year, and I think we started winning right from the start, and it's a lot easier to play when you're winning.
Back home in the friendly Spectrum, the Flyers were stung by an early John Busick goal. But from that moment on, it was Flyers, babe. Only Flyers, babe.
Now Barber, the Flyers skating 4-on-3 over the line. Crosses to Clark. He can't reach it, and it ricochets instead to McLeish, deep into the left wing corner. Back to Clark. Clark looks for Bladen. He'll get the forehand drive. Let's it go, and it was wide, and he had the corner. Back to Clark at the near point. He closes in. Closes in. Goes to Bladen again. He's got a point-blank shot.
Puck away in front. Shot. Up to Barber from Zaleski. Trying to go in. Looks to center. Four. Nice tie-up job. Zaleski tries to center. He's jammed up by Cashman. Puck loose in front. Shot.
Leading 2-1, the Flyers came out smoking.
Dallas Smith penetrating to Schmott. Wants to go on the shot. Cleared up nicely by McLeish to Barber. Back to McLeish, who comes to the Boston line. Over the line. Wants to hold. Dumps a pass right into Esposito's stick. Flips to center ice. Cleared away from Cashman by Jimmy Watson. 5:44 remaining in regulation play. Bad day from the blue line. Off Perron's glove side, and it's played to Jimmy Watson. Up along the near side. Pass. Carom to Billy Barber. Barber looking for Lonsbury on the carom. Orr beats him to it. Doesn't get it out. Barber penetrating. Shot! Look for Orr to come out as Esposito's out there now. Dallas Smith up on the far wing. Feeds to Vadney. Vadney will shoot from center ice. It bounces off the skate to the side of Perron. Coming around the near side of the net. Jimmy Watson loses it to Espo. Stolen though by Chris, and Chris failed by Clark. Brings to center ice. Through to Bobby. Over the line. Holds at the point, going into that far circle. Wants to throw it in on the net. Crosses to Dupont. Hill going right on in. He'll shoot. No!
With emotions running high in this all-important game, fireworks broke out on the ice. The Bruins took quick advantage of the changing complexion of the game to tie it at the end of the first period. After a vicious but scoreless second period, the game was still tied. But in the third period, the inspired Flyers took command. The fabulous Flyers had the Bruins pinned to the mat. One more win, and the Flyers would make history as the first expansion team to drink from Lord Stanley's cherished $48.50 mug. But back at Boston Garden, the Bruins went at the Flyers with all they had. Game 6 took place on a warm spring Sunday afternoon in the city of brotherly love. It was to be an immortal day. It ranked right up there with July 4th, 1776. It was the day of the Flyers. Kate Smith began it all.
God bless America, land that I light from above, from the mountains to the prairies to the ocean.
It was a spectacular performance by a spectacular team. The Flyers couldn't, wouldn't be beat. Bernie Parent was immense in goal, and Rick McLeish tipped in the one and only goal of the game in the first period.
All right, McLeish again with Shepard. Back to DuPont, goes to the forehand, flips on the net, score! Oh!
Bernie Parent was unbeatable in the goal.
The puck coming back to center ice. Hodge challenged by Kindrichuk. Backhands it to Vatney at center on the left wing. Fires on Ferruzzi. Covers the puck. Then has to give it around to the near side for Joe Watson. Up to Schultz. He can't handle it. Riley going right and in. And a great save by Parent as Schultz coughed up the puck to Terry O'Reilly. At the line. Drops back to Cashman. Flyers drop back. Cashman in close. Shot. That one hit the skate of DuPont and deflected into the far corner. DuPont tries to take out Esposito. Can't. Crossed by Vadney over to Orr. Back to Vadney. He'll go right on in. Shot. Save. It's loose in front. And Ferrant gets it out of the corner and hangs on just as the penalty is to expire and the change at full strength. Stolen by Esposito. Comes with Cashman and Dallas Smith over the line. Gets by Joe Watson. Shot. Save. Rebound in front.
In the closing minutes, the Flyers pressed doggedly. Finally, Bobby Clark stole the puck, broke away alone toward the Bruins net when Bobby Orr intercepted him.
2:40 left in regulation play as it goes to Cashman. Playing on the near side to Hart with a shot. And a marvelous save by Perron on the long side as Barber plays it up to Chris. And now it's back Clark on a breakaway. Clark going in. He spun around and Orr will go off with just 2:23 remaining in the game. Orr for holding Bobby Clark. And now Orr is furious at Art Stove. And he was held off by Hodge.
From there on, it was Flyers all the way.
No icing, of course, with the Bruins having a man in the box. Wound by Van Imp along the near side. Back into the Boston zone. Orr will be out in 7 seconds. Now Cashman tries to get going. Down into the Boston Flyers zone. Down behind Perron. Van Imp off the boards looking for McLeish. Can't get it out. Now it comes to center as Orr is out there with 15 seconds. Puck goes to Barber down into the Boston zone. 13 seconds left in the game. 10 seconds. Orr shoots it down the ice. Perron makes the save. Ladies and gentlemen, the Flyers are going to win the Stanley Cup! The Flyers win the Stanley Cup! The Flyers win the Stanley Cup! The Flyers have won the Stanley Cup!
Bernie, of course you won the Conn Smythe, which makes you the outstanding player of the playoffs. Now, goaltenders are not supposed to do that. That's supposed to go to the other dudes, you know.
Well, you know, I think that Conn Smythe on this team here, the whole team deserves that trophy. You know, we should put the whole team, you know, because it's we had few injuries before, and the bench came through. You know, we won games, and I think it's a whole team effort.
Rick, you're the leading scorer in the Stanley Cup playoffs. How do you feel?
I feel great, but I feel more it's helped the team, you know, and every goal I get, it's a contribution to the whole team. Like, it's the whole team that's doing it, you know. It's might be one player that scores the goal, but it's the whole effort of the team that puts it together.
Could you describe the goal?
Well, I won the faceoff, and I went back to DuPont, and he shot it, and then I saw it coming through, but defenseman took me, but I was facing it, and I just hit my stick, went in the corner.
Phil, you had a knee injury. You came back. You played a good game in Boston. Yep. And here you probably played. It's the best game I've ever seen you play. Did you feel this was your best performance?
Well, it was for such a cause. I don't think I could argue with that. I missed a couple of golden opportunities. Puck jumped over my stick a couple of times. It's the happiest day of my life. I felt like I was out there partly for Barry Ashby, for Dorney, and for Bob Kelly, because I was fortunate enough to come off of my injury. I got out of that cast and did a lot of work, and I was determined I was going to get back in, and I know what they're missing, and I felt like I was out there working for them and for the rest of the team. I missed a lot of games this year, and I felt that every time I played, I was playing for the other guys on the team. It's the happiest day of my life, and with 150% effort from everybody, and I mean every individual on the team, we couldn't miss. That was the secret. We contained Bobby Orr. Every time we got a chance, we rubbed him, we isolated him from the play. When you cut him off, you kill the Bruins, and everybody was doing it right.
The Flyers had done it all. They were proud, but Philadelphians were even prouder. They went wild at the Victory Motorcade. They deserved it. The Flyers deserved it. God bless the Flyers.